In this presentation, we will see about monoalphabetic ciphers. Let's see the outcomes first. Upon the completion of the session, the learner will be able to outcome number 1, we will recall the Caesar cipher. Outcome number 2, we will understand permutation. Outcome number 3, we will understand monoalphabetic ciphers with example. And outcome number 4, we will know the pros and cons of monoalphabetic ciphers. In the last presentation, we have already seen about Caesar ciphers. In this presentation, we are mainly going to focus on the monoalphabetic ciphers. And we know basically the classical encryption technique has two types. Number 1, the substitution technique, and number 2 is the transposition technique. We are now in the substitution technique. In substitution technique, we have a lot of techniques like the Caesar cipher, monoalphabetic cipher, Playfair, Hill, polyalphabetic ciphers, one-time pairs, and many other things are there. And in this presentation, we are going to focus on the monoalphabetic cipher. Before stepping into what is monoalphabetic cipher, we will just recall what is Caesar cipher. We know in Caesar cipher, the letters are substituted or replaced by other letters or symbols. And this is one of the oldest methods or the earlier known and the simplest method used by Julius Caesar. And how this Caesar cipher works? Caesar cipher works on the principle replacing each letter of the alphabet with the letter standing 3 places further down the alphabet. Suppose if we are going to encrypt the alphabet G, I mean G is the plain text letter, then the ciphertext for G is J, that is this letter. How did we get this? It means G, we are going to move 3 places down. 1, 2, 3. So, for the plain text letter G, J is the ciphertext. And for any letter in Caesar cipher, 3 is the key. And we are going to replace every letter of the plain text standing down 3 positions. So, the key value is 3. So, the difference is uniform between the plain text letter and the ciphertext letter throughout the message. We have also seen that brute force attack can devastate the working of Caesar cipher. And that's why we are going for the next approach, the monoalphabetic cipher. In monoalphabetic cipher, the cipher line can be any permutation of the 26 alphabetic characters. So, here the cipher line can be any permutation. And we know we are talking about the language English. So, any permutation of 26 alphabetic characters. In order to understand things clear, we should first understand what is permutation. Firstly, we will focus on permutation. A permutation of a finite set of elements S. Please note, this is a finite set of elements, not an infinite set of elements. A permutation of a finite set of elements S is an ordered sequence of all the elements of S. Say, we have seen S is a set. And this S is going to contain some finite set of elements. And these finite set of elements are going to be arranged in an ordered sequence such that each element appearing exactly once. We will see an example, it will be more clear for you to understand. Say, let's take the set S. This S contains 3 elements A, B and C. Since it contains 3 elements, we can say it is a finite set of elements. So, in this example, the set S is having finite set of elements, to be precise, 3 elements. And the elements are A, B and C. Now, what is permutation? Now, we are going to apply an order sequence of all the elements of S. The elements of S are A, B and C and we are going to arrange order sequence of all the elements. Let's see the permutation of this S now. So, there are 6 permutations of S. Let's see what are they. A, B, C, A, C, B. BAC, BCA, CAB, CBA. So, we are getting all possibilities of the combinations A, B and C as the output in permutation. How many possibilities we get? 6, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So, since there are 3 elements, we get 6 possibilities. If there are n elements, n factorial outputs we will get in permutation. Say, if there are 2 elements, let's say AB. So, the possibilities are AB, BA. So, 2 factorial which is equal to 2 only. In this case, it is 3 factorial. So, 3 into 2 into 1. 3 into 2 into 1 is 6 and that's why we got 6 possibilities. In case if we have 4 elements, 4 factorial. So, 4 multiplied by 3 multiplied by 2 multiplied by 1. So, 4 into 3 into 2 into 1 which is 24. So, this is about permutation. So, in monoalphabetic substitution technique, this permutation is going to be the logic. Please do remember, Monoalphabetic substitution technique is not a permutation cipher, whereas it is going to use a logic that is related to this permutation. Anyway, we will understand this when we see an example. Let's go back to the previous slide. So, in monoalphabetic cipher, the cipher line can be any permutation of the 26 alphabetic characters. Don't worry about this point now. When we see an example, we will understand this. So, obviously, this would seem to eliminate brute force technique for cryptanalysis. In CISA cipher, there is a uniform key difference between the plain text and the ciphertext. To be precise, 3 is the difference. If the attacker is able to find out the key value for one plain text ciphertext combo, it means he has found out the key for the entire message. But here, in monoalphabetic cipher, this is not going to be the uniform key difference between the plain text character and the ciphertext character. And it can be a permutation, any possible combination. We will see that shortly. So, we can understand that a single cipher alphabet mapping from plain text alphabet to ciphertext alphabet is used per message. It means there is going to be a mapping, and this mapping is going to help us to eliminate brute force technique on monoalphabetic cipher. There is a drawback associated with this technique. Since we are dealing with the plain text and ciphertext in English language and the nature of plain text is known, this drawback you will understand once we see an example. Let's see an example now. We know this table, A is mapped to 0 and Z is mapped to 25, right? And the sequential ordering is there. Suppose if we want to encrypt the plain text NESO, N-E-S-O, how we are going to do that? Any random fashion you can do it. N can be mapped to D, E can be mapped to U, S can be mapped to L, or O can be mapped to A. So this mapping can be anything. It can be a permutation concept also. You can randomly map it to any letter. Say if you map N to D, you can't map another letter or another plain text letter to D because already D is mapped for N. Since it is a substitution technique, just substitute every letter of the mapping so that you will get the ciphertext. Let's see that now. So the ciphertext is DULADULA. How did we get that? Because N is substituted as D, E is substituted as U, S is substituted as L, and O is substituted as A. This is the logic behind monoalphabetic cipher. We need to note one thing here. The difference between the plain text letter and the ciphertext letter is not uniform in the monoalphabetic ciphering technique. In the CISA cipher, the difference between the plain text ciphertext characters, any plain text, any ciphertext combo, it will be one and the same. To be precise, the difference will be 3 in CISA cipher. In shift cipher, the difference between the plain text ciphertext letter will be the same for all plain text ciphertext combo. In this monoalphabetic technique, the difference between the plain text ciphertext letters will not be the same. I mean, the difference between the plain text ciphertext letter ND is not the same as the plain text ciphertext letters EU and for S, L and for OA. So if you note the difference, it will be different because randomly we are mapping. So we will not find the uniform difference for all the plain text ciphertext letters in this scheme. In simple terms, how many possibilities we have? How many letters in the plain text we have? 4, right? So 4 factorial possibilities we can have. Out of 4 factorial possibilities, this DULA will be one of the outputs. When you do the permutation, you will find this DULA. So if the message is very small and if you have only 26 alphabets, so 26 factorial would be the answer. So 26 factorial attempts are required in order to break this monoalphabetic. But comparing this with the CISA cipher, this is powerful than CISA cipher. I mean, the monoalphabetic substitution technique is powerful than CISA cipher because in CISA cipher, 25 attempts would be sufficient to break the key or to know the key. Whereas here, 26 factorial. This monoalphabetic ciphering technique is also not powerful enough because the main drawback is with the nature of the language. We know English is the language which is widely used, but still if you see this graph, the relative frequency of English letters is depicted here. If you observe here, the alphabets are in x-axis and the relative frequency of appearance of the alphabets in y-axis. This is the nature of the appearance of the letters or the relative frequency of English letters. If you observe here, which letter in English is occurring the most or predominantly appearing? This graph says that E is the letter which can occur 12.702% in the sentence, followed by the alphabet T, which is the next widely used alphabet after E. I'll stop with this example. So from this we can conclude that E is the most widely used alphabet followed by T. And we have other letters also. This analysis shows that the frequency or the relative frequency of English letters. With the knowledge of this relative frequency of English letters, we can easily break the monoalphabetic ciphers. Let's see how it can be broken. This is the ciphertext. If you observe here in the ciphertext, which letter is appearing the most? If you see, P is the letter which is appearing 13.33% in the whole ciphertext. Followed by P, Z is the letter which is appearing 11.67%. If you see here, P is predominantly seen followed by Z. So, if P is the ciphertext letter, what could be the plain text letter? Just recollect the graph. In this graph, we know E is the letter which is appearing predominantly in English followed by the alphabet T. In this example, P is predominantly seen followed by Z. So, the possibility for P could be E and the possibility for Z could be T. So, this is how we can guess. Since in this example, we have a bigger ciphertext, why don't we take a smaller ciphertext and do this analysis again? I will take a simple example so that you will understand it clearly. Let's take this ciphertext and I am placing the ciphertext like this. Now, which letter is appearing the most? If you observe here, G is the letter which is appearing the most. We know in English, E is the most widely used letter. This ciphertext letter G could be E. So, I am just placing E and then followed by T. Which is the next letter that is widely used? Since every letter is appearing only once, I am trying with T. So, I am just using V could be T and then I am trying C could be A and I am trying P could be N and N could be L, R could be P. Based on the relative frequency of the letters, I am just doing this mapping. And if you observe here, I can see somewhat readable text, E something plan, isn't it? So, the plain text corresponding to this ciphertext could be execute plan. So, this is actually a guessing attack. So, this relative frequency of English letters is helping us to guess what could be the ciphertext. Let's go back to the previous example. So, in this example, we have figured out the possibility for P could be E. So, I am just putting E in all the places of P. And I am substituting T in place of Z. And I am also filling some other characters like A, H. Now I am getting some readable text. Can you see here? Here it is that. When there is T, H, the possibility it could be the. Then here also I have some readable text. If you keenly do this permutation concept or if you keenly observe the readability or if you try guessing attack, you will find the message will be, it was disclosed yesterday that several informal but direct contacts have been made with political representatives of the Viet Cong in Moscow. We can get this message based on either permutation or by guessing attack. And that's it about the operation of monoalphabetic ciphers. Before we conclude, let's see the pros and cons of monoalphabetic ciphers. We'll start with the pros. Actually, this is providing better security than Caesar cipher because brute force attack is not literally easy in monoalphabetic ciphers. Of course, brute force attack is possible, but just comparing it with the Caesar cipher, brute force attack becomes somewhat tougher. And coming to the cons, these monoalphabetic ciphers are easy to break because they reflect the frequency data of the original alphabet. So, we have seen the English letter relative frequency of every alphabet and we can easily break this monoalphabetic ciphers based on the relative frequency of English letters. Also, this technique is vulnerable or prone to guessing attack using English letter frequency of occurrence of letters. Is there any solution for this? Of course, there is a technique. There is a countermeasure. It is to provide multiple substitutes known as homophones for a single letter. Based on the sound, we can assign substitution. So, I am not going to talk about this elaborately. Just you can go for homophones so that you can get better monoalphabetic ciphering technique. Before we sign out, let's see the homework question. Encrypt the plain text, attack postponed to tomorrow and do not use our secret paper until further info. Using monoalphabetic ciphering technique. So, you are given with the plain text and the key is given. The key is the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. Now, there is a note which is provided here, ignore the second and letter occurrence of alphabets in the key. It means, you need to provide the mapping for A with T, isn't it? That's what it is given actually. So, A is mapped to T, this T is mapped to H, so obviously this T is also mapped to H, and this A is already mapped to T, right? So, this A will also be T only, so this is the key actually. So, in monoalphabetic technique, we can randomly assign alphabets to the plain text letters or we can use a sentence like this. so that this sentence will be easy for the sender and the receiver to remember this. Because when the sender encrypts the message, the receiver needs to decrypt the message. So they need to mutually agree upon the key, because this is a symmetric encryption where the same key should be used for both encryption and decryption. So sender and receiver should easily remember the key. So it's better to go with these kind of sentences as the key. So try assigning every alphabet to the unique alphabet in the secret key and then generate the ciphertext. And post your answers in the comment section. And that's it, guys. We recalled the Caesar cipher. We understood the permutation. We also have understood the monoalphabetic ciphers with example. And we also have come to know about the pros and cons of monoalphabetic ciphers. I'll see you in the next lecture, and thank you for watching.